I welcome members to the first meeting in 2016 of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee, and as always ask members to switch off mobile phones, please. Agenda item one is a decision on taking business in private. It's proposed the committee takes item eight in private. This will enable the committee to consider further the Delegated Powers provisions in the Burial and Cremation Scotland Bill at stage one. Is the committee happy to do that? Thank you very much indeed. Agenda item two is the Bankruptcy Scotland Bill, and this item of business is for the committee to consider the draft as response to the committee's questions on matters relating to the bill. Do members have any comments on those, please? Is the committee content to note their response? Thank you very much indeed. That takes us to agenda item three, which is again the Bankruptcy Scotland Bill, but on this item we take oral evidence. And it is a great pleasure to welcome the Minister for Business, Energy and Tourism, Fergus Ewing, MSP. Alex Reid, Head of Operational Policy and Compliance for the Accountant in Bankruptcy. Graham Fisher, who's the Head of Branch 1, Civil and Constitutional Law Division of the Scottish Government Legal Directorate. And Gregor Clark, who is, of course, the Parliamentary Counsel of the Scottish Law Commission. Good morning, gentlemen. It's very good to see you all. I understand the Minister may want to make an opening statement.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much. Here to yourself, the members, and everyone else gathered here this morning. I wanted just to make a few brief opening remarks to set the context, if I may. And first of all, really to thank the Scottish Law Commission, represented by Gregor Clark here today, for the enormous amount of work that has been involved in getting to this stage, probably 99% of the work, and to all the members of the SLC that are not here but who have contributed to that work. The time is, I think, right to bring Scotland's bankruptcy legislation into one place. This will aid the accessibility and understanding of bankruptcy law for practitioners and those affected by it, and in turn save a great deal of time and resource. And as the committee knows, the main legislation for consolidation is the Bankruptcy Scotland Act 1985, which has been heavily amended and as a result has lost coherence and structure. Many provisions are inordinately long and numbering has become complex and unwieldy. This bill will put Scotland's bankruptcy legislation in one place, aiding the accessibility and understanding of bankruptcy law for practitioners and for those affected by it. Over time, it will save both time and resource for everyone using the legislation. The substantive changes to bankruptcy law by the Bankruptcy and Debt Advice Scotland Act 2014 are fully implemented and in effect from the 1st of April last year, providing a good opportunity to bring the legislation together. Further delay, convener, would waste an opportunity if the consolidating work done by the SLC is superseded as the law is gradually amended over time. We are, in addition to our gratitude to the SLC, very grateful for the time that members and clerks and the Scottish Parliament have spent in the scrutiny of this bill to date and the approach taken in communicating relevant issues with the drafter and with the Scottish Government. The feedback from stakeholders, I think, is fair to characterise as having been broadly positive, namely that there is a consensus, a wide view in recognising that this action in bringing together the statute book into one document is necessary and timely.
Thank you very much, Minister. I suspect that's outlined the rationale for the consolidation, and our questions will be started by John Scott, who I'm sure will want to know how it fits into the wider policy.
Thank you. Good morning, Minister, and a good new year to you and your officials. Minister, how does the bill relate to the Scottish Government's wider policy objectives on bankruptcy?
Well, it is a consolidation bill, so the purpose of the bill is to bring the law into one document. And it relates to the wider purpose of our bankruptcy law in reflecting a balance between the interests of debtors and creditors, By having the provisions in one document, it will, I think, do a couple of things. First of all, it will, as I've said, provide a much-needed simplicity for those who need to refer to the law. And secondly, I think it demonstrates the importance that the Scottish Government attach to bankruptcy law and the importance of having it accessible, that we are devoting quite a lot of time and effort between us all to that task. If this were a sort of fringe activity, we wouldn't be here. We wouldn't be doing this. I mean, the last thing I would say is that when I was myself in private practice and the practitioner, I spent countless hours poring over the Bankruptcy Scotland Act 1985, which followed in itself from a Royal Commission, as I recall. And then when the 1993 Act came in, things became a little bit more complicated. Fortunately, I escaped from private practice before the Bankruptcy Diligence Act 2007, not to mention the homeowners and debtors protection legislation, and bringing up the rear, the badass bill, as it's known in the streets. So to have so many pieces of legislation which between them constitute the law in Scotland relating to bankruptcy is makes no sense at all. Therefore, a simplicity, accessibility of the law for everybody in Scotland, not only practitioners, but users as well, I think is inherently both a good and a sensible thing.
Excellent. Thank you very much.
Richard, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister. We've heard about the difficulties facing users of the current bankruptcy legislation. Given the wide-ranging reforms introduced by both the Bankruptcy and Debt Advice Scotland Act 2014, or BADAS as it's known on the streets, and by other amending legislation over the years, which you've referred to yourself, Minister, in your own travails with those with that legislation. Do you not think users of bankruptcy legislation, therefore, would not have benefited from a consolidation exercise taking place earlier as part of the 2013 bill?
I think we've proceeded in the correct way. It was necessary for us to bring forward the Bankruptcy and Debt Advice Scotland Act in 2014. And that had to be done. I think it was sensible that that was done first. That was planned for a long time. The reforms, I think, were necessary. They had widespread cross-party support. Had we brought in the Consolidation Act before that, then it would immediately have become, if you like, to some extent, out of date, because it would then have had to have been reformed by the 2014 Act. So I think the order in which things have been done, although not as quick as some may like, including myself as a minister from time to time, I have to say, and the time it takes for governments to do things, but be that as it may, there is a reason for this. It's a highly complex thing to do, to consolidate legislation. There are many aspects, some others of which we'll no doubt come on to in relations with the UK, in relations to the law of debt. So I think that although it has been a long time coming, the sequence of law reform first and then consolidation was the correct one. And perhaps I could add, I think that point has a further validity when one reflects that although there are already identified several ways in which the bankruptcy law needs to be further reformed, none of these I would describe as particularly significant. In other words, what we will do by passing a consolidated piece of legislation should be to leave a bequest or a legacy which will, I think, have some utility for some time to come, although, of course, there will be amendments to it, but none are contemplated, so far as I'm aware, which are what I would categorise as a major or hugely significant in nature. Now, I mean, I've answered it in the way that I've seen appropriate, but I don't know if Mr. Clark or Mr. Fisher would have anything to add to the timing issue.
I think there comes a point when you have to decide to go for it. This area of law, a lot of changes have happened in recent years. I'm surprised that practitioners can actually manage to use the existing law efficiently. It must take a great deal of time just to construct text for themselves. I think this was very much the moment. It's obviously the consolidation couldn't immediately follow in the 2014 Act because there was so much work still to be done in bringing that material into the bulk of the consolidation. But I think we progressed with considerable speed, really, considering the scale of the changes.
Thank you, Mr. Clark. Just a follow-up from that. I mean, you explained, Minister, the reasoning behind the approach you've taken and the consequential approach in terms of legislation. But is there still a danger of confusion among stakeholders, given the recent changes which have been introduced as part of the 2014 Act and this bill following hot on the heels of that?
All of the changes in the 2014 Act will, as I understand it, be brought into force by April last year.
That's right. April last year, the 1st of April.
Therefore, given that this bill, as I understand it, intended to be commenced in April next year, that there will be sufficient time, I think, for practitioners to garner the practical changes in their applications and procedures, for example, in IP's work, consequential upon the 2014 Act prior to the consolidation bill coming in. But I think, as Mr. Clark has said, the huge difficulty in trying to work out what the law actually is and piece it all together when it is contained in six or seven different documents, that huge effort, which must occupy an enormous amount of time, particularly in any case which involves an element of interpretation or difficulty rather than, if you like, a routine case, all that time will be saved. So I think the advantages would substantially outweigh any notional problem. And as I say, the Badass Act has been implemented in full and will have been so for a full 2 years prior to the expected date of commencement of this consolidated piece of legislation. I'll just check if I've got all that correct. Mr. Fisher,
the commencement of the consolidated bill is anticipated for November this year rather than April. So I think the position there is that there will have been a significant period of time for the Badass changes to have bedded in with practitioners, and also some period of time to fully communicate with stakeholders on the impending consolidation bill.
Thank you.
The committee's also heard from officials about what was described as a marginal hole which would be created in the law of England and Wales should a section 104 order not be made. And this has been a part of the committee's consideration around the timescale for this consolidation. Can I ask, Minister, if you're aware how this order is progressing and what dialogue you and your team have had around the progress around that order?
I'm certainly briefed about some of the issues involved, but I'm not aware where currently we stand in relation to practice. So perhaps Mr. Fisher, with permission, could answer that question.
Thank you. Just to say we've been in ongoing discussions with the UK government on the basis of the trying to agree the detail of the Section 104 order, and that's proceeding in line with the timetables that the Scotland Office have set down, as I think indicated previously. Obviously, there's a lot of departments whose legislation is impacted by this bill simply because it's making straightforward technical changes to update that legislation in all those different areas. So, for instance, DWP, but also a host of departments who, whose legislation is being amended, and that that obviously takes some time, but there's no anticipated difficulties in having that agreed, and that probably in the next couple of weeks, and we'll keep the committee updated on that as the bill goes forward.
Thank you, and I think we'd like to be reassured that that's on track, but certainly, Ms. Fisher, as you describe it, it does appear to be so.
Stevenson, want to point on that?
I I heard Mr. Fisher say a lot of departments, and he was referring to Westminster departments, in making that reference were impacted. I'm sure there's goodwill and a willingness to work with the Parliament here. What's the practical effect if there is a gap between the law in Scotland, as affected by the Succession Bill being changed, and the 104 order taking place at a period after the coming into operation? What is the practical effect?
Yeah, I think I mentioned before in my evidence that the intention is very much that there won't be any gap in timing, and that the 104 order will have effect at, you know, as planned and as has been scheduled on the same timescale as the bill, and there would be no, I mean, there's no intention to commence the bill before those arrangements are in place.
I do forgive me, and I'm absolutely certain that what you say is correct today, but schedules are schedules, implementation is another matter, and I really must press you, is there a practical effect, and if so, what is it, if there is a discontinuity, or is the matter simply one that would be resolved by the commencement order for the Succession Bill being aligned with the 104 process?
Yes, I mean, like you say, I think if in that eventuality, which I don't think is a significant possibility, but in that eventuality, I think you're right that can be taken into account in the commencement of the bankruptcy bill, and that would mean that there's not a difficulty there with the effect.
Richard.
Thank you, Vina. And finally, for me, at its evidence session on 17th November, the committee heard about the Scottish Government's plans to lay a package of secondary legislation in the autumn involving stakeholders. So, Mr. I wonder if you could update the committee about the Scottish Government's intentions to work with stakeholders in development of this package of secondary legislation, or if a member of your team could help enlighten the committee in this matter.
I can say we work very closely with stakeholders, with the money advice sector, with ICAS, with bodies such as R3, and I had the pleasure of addressing ICAS at its conference not so long ago, held at Glen Eagles. We have frequent and deep engagement with the relevant stakeholders, and that has been so for some time. But perhaps Mr. Reid could address some of the detail in relation to the subordinate legislation package.
Yep. We'll be working on bringing in subordinate legislation along with the consolidation bill, and within that there'll be opportunity to further consolidate some of the regulations that support the existing legislation. So that's been worked through just now, and the schedule will be with due consultation with stakeholders to introduce the regulations in the next parliamentary term after the summer recess, and that would allow for the legislation to be introduced for the commencement of the bill.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. John Messon, please.
Convener. I mean, there clearly has been quite a lot of changes, quite significant changes in bankruptcy law in recent years, which is why we've come to this point of the consolidation. And I think you said, Minister, that you are fairly confident that in the future there would not be more significant changes to legislation, or at least in the near future. I mean, is there a reason why you think, you know, we have concluded the major changes and there won't be major changes that reappear in the next couple of years?
Well, the basis for reaching the conclusion that there's unlikely to be as significant changes in the next few years as there has in the past is simply that we have made very substantial changes, and we have done so after having had a careful reflection and discussion with stakeholders, many of whom have sought the changes that we have made, especially in the money advice sector. Whilst there are some issues that are still extant and need to be dealt with, you know, I'm not aware in relation to bankruptcy law as opposed to law of debt that there are necessarily a huge number of issues which would be regarded as significant. I think that was the word that I've used. In other words, we've done most of the heavy lifting on the main issues of concern, particularly in relation to, you know, measures to protect the family home, for example. Therefore, I think most of the major changes have, if you like, been encapsulated in the pieces of legislation that I outlined earlier. Of course, that's simply my view, and others may disagree, and that's absolutely fine. And even if I'm wrong, I mean, we will still, if this consolidated legislation goes ahead, we will still provide clarity, simplicity, accessibility, and therefore it will be simpler, more accessible to enable those who perhaps have more radical views about bankruptcy form to look at the law in one place, in one document, in the task of seeking to reform that law, rather than having to look at a plethora of whole documents. So even if I'm wrong, I don't think that would be an argument against the approach that we are taking. I don't know if anyone else wants to make any comment on that. No. Okay.
And I mean, assuming there will be kind of minor changes at least going forward,
yeah.
I mean, clearly one of the arguments for having this consolidation is that there's now a very clear structure where before it was very piecemeal. I mean, are you confident that, you know, we can take that structure and it can be maintained even if there are some minor amendments to it?
Yes, I'm absolutely confident that that's the case. And really, the structure of the bill starts off with the application for sequestration, then the award of sequestration. In that, I mean, it follows a long established pattern, as I understand it, dating back to I think, the 1913 Bankruptcy Act, and if my memory serves me correct, and the 85 Act, which follows that model. I mean, it starts at the beginning and it works through to the end of the process. It's a logical, I mean, there is various, you know, minor kind of points about that, but the basic structure of the Act starts at the beginning and it works through to the end. I think ICAS or R3 suggested put the definitions at the beginning. Well, that's possible, but it's not, you know, it's not a sort of fundamental change. And therefore, to answer your point directly, you know, this bill will provide a working tool for all those that need it. It will be useful for those who need it to advise clients, for people who want themselves to do a wee bit of self-research. It will be useful for people who have a reforming a mien. It will be useful for all of those to encapsulate the law of Scotland in one place. But, you know, I would be very surprised indeed were there not to be changes brought in fairly swiftly. I mean, one example for that, which I wanted specifically to mention, is that, and ICAS have quite rightly drawn attention to this, is that certain changes were introduced through the Small Business Enterprise and Employment Act 2015, and this has extended the scope of essential supplies to insolvent businesses to include IT and communication equipment. And as a consequence, there will, I think, be a need to consider whether, in order to bring clarity to the law of Scotland in that specific matter, whether changes will be made. And I must admit, I'm very sympathetic to those changes being made, perhaps in the next session of this Parliament, if legislators then, whoever they may be, think that's a good idea. I certainly do think it's a good idea, but that's not a reason for not doing what we're doing now. That's a relatively small change, a minor change. It may not require primary legislation, I don't know, I haven't looked into it, but I suspect it probably will, but it can be an amendment to that. I mean, law reform, sadly or not, well, it doesn't really matter, is not a static process. It's a dynamic process. It goes on. This bill, when we pass it, will be amended probably quite quickly. But that doesn't in any way detract, I think, from the force of the arguments of having this consolidated bill.
Thanks very much. I mean, I think some of my colleagues will go back onto structure later on, so we'll leave that just now. One of the things we've been looking at is whether all the relevant legislation has been brought together. And we've had witnesses, some of whom totally agreed it had been, but we've had some witnesses, for example, ICAS, who have suggested that the debt arrangement scheme should also be included in the bill. I should say I'm a member of ICAS, but do not consider myself bound by all their views. And the point's been made by yourself, I think, and others, Minister, that part of the reason for all of this consolidation is to make it easier for users, And the ICAR's argument, I think, is that, well, a user might be considering the debt arrangement scheme, therefore it should be in there as well, even though it's not technically bankruptcy. And I just wondered what your thoughts were on that issue.
Well, I certainly acknowledge the argument, and I was interested to read earlier in preparation for this meeting of the way in which ICAS put it forward. And I fully understand that from a petitioner's point of view, why they did so. There is a certain rationale for that, but I think it is substantially overridden by the fact that the debt arrangement scheme is not bankruptcy law. The debt arrangement scheme is a method which has been brought forward by Parliament, I think back in 2005, and has been highly successful in allowing people to pay off their debts in full or nearly in full. Now, that's entirely different from bankruptcy. The whole concept of bankruptcy is to provide a process whereby people have relief from their debts. In other words, DAS is a mechanism and it's a species of debt law, not of bankruptcy law. Were we to conclude that DAS should be in the bankruptcy law, then actually the argument would be that the whole of debt law should become part of the consolidated bill. Plainly, that would be an impossible, well, it would be an enormous task, and one which would then conflate the law of debt with the law of bankruptcy. Now, if one subscribes to the view, as I do, that we should be, and we have, taken steps to make it possible and relatively easy for people to pay off their debts in full, rather than seek to have relief of their debts and be discharged from the debts without paying them, then I think it is logical then to say that debt law is entirely different in principle from bankruptcy law and should not be treated as it were part of bankruptcy law. Therefore, I think that's the primary reason why I think ICAS, although I understand entirely their arguments, may want to reflect further on these issues. I think I'm correct in saying, and officials will correct me if this is not the case, that R3 took a somewhat different view and didn't think that that DAS should be consolidated. Moreover, I think I'd be bound to reflect, convener, that at the recent members' debate on DAS, there was a considerable number of opinions expressed from the backbenches, but opinions expressed from a variety of parties that possible further major reform of DAS could be contemplated. That's what I recall was part of the debate there. So, I would be astonished were there not serious discussion about further serious amendments to DAS, and that's very much a live issue and of a significant nature, all designed to try to help people pay off their debts in full. So I think that's the major reason. Alec, is there anything else that you wanted to add to that?
I don't think so. Possibly just worth highlighting the views as well as R3 of Money Advice Scotland, who were from a money advice perspective, were quite strongly in favour of keeping DAS aside from the consolidated bill.
Okay, thank you.
Come on. Just wanted to pick up the Minister made the point that debt law is a very large subject, and I just wondered if you were able to tell us, because I don't know the answer to this, whether all of debt law is in fact devolved, and I was thinking in particular as whether commercial debt law was devolved, whereas personal debt law it would be, albeit I recognise that, of course, if we were restating undevolved matters, we would be able to do that in a consolidation bill. But I put that to one side and just ask the general question as to whether all of debt law is, in fact, devolved, and that might create an issue if one were to bring the whole of debt law together.
Well, I suppose the answer lies in is it Schedule 5 of the Scotland Act 98. But my understanding is that personal debt law is substantially devolved, and that corporate insolvency is substantially not. And that, broadly speaking, is the distinction. But there is a slight blurring, as so often is the case, at the edges. But I think the point I was trying to make was not really reserve versus devolved. It's that the law of debt encompasses a very, very wide range of issues, which, entirely, I mean, I we could give you a long list if you want. It's a long time since I read the textbooks, decades, I think, but happily. But it's a much wider topic, and it includes areas like diligence, various types of diligence, which precede bankruptcy, obviously. And it also includes the law of obligations, gratuitous, onerous, gifts, contracts. And so this is a very wide area of law. And DAS really is one vehicle, a species of statute. It's really a scheme where people are protected from diligence and given the surety of being free from the worry of the sheriff officer at their door or the threat of action being taken to do the full force of the law. So it's really a scheme. So the idea that it should be part of a bankruptcy bill, I think, in principle, would offend most traditionally educated Scottish lawyers. I don't know if there's anything else to add to coming to traditionally educated Scottish lawyers.
I think that's yeah. Most of it. I mean, I would agree there are some specific reserve matters which are impacted on by the general law of debt, and that's a very relevant consideration. Yep.
I now turn to John Scott, who I think will take us on to Scottish Law Commission recommendations.
Thank you very much, convener. And just there were two consequential amendments are needed to the 1985 Act, which were lost sight of when two SLC recommendations were implemented by the 2014 Act. These consequential amendments are proposed to be made via the bill. However, the consequential amendments, as we understand it, are not mentioned in the SLC recommendation, so could be viewed as being outside the scope of a consolidation bill. Does the Minister intend to explore the alternative route of making these consequential amendments via an order under Section 55 of the 2014 Act?
Right. I've got a full briefing here and I've looked at it, but I think it's probably simpler if Mr. Fisher just answered the question, if that's permissible.
Yes, basically we laid the order on the 21st of December, so that's now before the Parliament. So that's obviously subject to consideration by the Parliament. But yes, that'll be through in time for the end of the parliamentary session, assuming that the Parliament agrees to pass the order.
Dealt with then.
Yes.
Right, thanks very much. And just ask you briefly, what was the Scottish Government's approach to assessing European Convention on Human Rights considerations in terms of those provisions of the Bill which remain substantially unchanged since their introduction pre-devolution?
That might be for me probably as well. Certainly, like any other bill, obviously the bill has to be competent within the test that the Section 29 of the Scotland Act sets for assessing competence, and part of that is the assessment of human rights convention compliance with the European Convention on Human Rights. So, as with any bill, the provisions of the bill, we were conscious that this was the first time that many of the provisions had been before the Parliament, so we had to consider the ECHR competence of the bill in the same way as any of the other provisions. And in relation to the 104 order, as I mentioned before, that we see that as part of the package, although the 104 order measures will only be scrutinised and approved by at Westminster, they're part of the package and they're obviously part of the current law, and insofar as the gaps that are filled in for the law of the rest of the UK, they only replicate the structures in the bill in any event, so the whole thing as a package has to effectively be compliant with the European Convention on Human Rights. And as with any bill, obviously the bill's achieved a certificate of competence from ministers and from the presiding officer, and the 104 order also reflects the same structures and the same consideration. Obviously, the Lord Advocate signed the certificate of competence for the bill, and those structures are reflected in the 104 order. So we can say that the bill and the 104 order have both been scrutinised to ensure that they're within competence on the basis of the convention, and that we're satisfied with that.
That's very clear. Thank you very much. You understand this is an area of great interest to us, but we welcome your absolute reassurance. We wish we could find it so regularly, to be honest, in other bills that have come in front of us, but we're grateful for your reassurance in this set of circumstances. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm wondering, Minister, whether I could take you forward to picking over individual words briefly. And the first one I'd like to start with is the word forthwith, which is in the 1985 Act and has often been changed, for reasons we understand, I have to say, to without delay in the bill. R3 have argued that provides a lack of consistency and could be deemed to change the meaning, and I'm just wondering whether you feel there's a risk that that might be the case, please.
Yes, well, we did discuss this earlier, but I think it may be imprudent for me to relay the terms of the conversation, so particularly in the context of the time in which ministers do things. But so I'll, in that case, pass to Mr. Clark, and perhaps he can express a view.
Well, forthwith, it was felt that the word was better replaced, given it's not really modern English. So there's rules of plain language and so on ought to kick in at that point. The trouble with forthwith is everybody knows what it means, but no two people can agree. The dictionary meaning, the Oxford Dictionary, says there are two meanings, immediately or without delay. And certainly to me as draftsman, and considering the process of bankruptcy as a whole, the idea of immediacy at every point in what is essentially an administrative process seemed too strict a test. And without delay, in the sense of just encouraging people to get on and not waste time, was the better word in relation to an administrative process. The 1985, it doesn't use forthwith in a consistent manner anyway. I mean, there are all manner of ways of expressing immediacy throughout. It really was a matter of trying to find some sort of consistency. I would have thought that forthwith, it has been the subject of litigation. In most places in the bill, it doesn't matter terribly much. In the one place where it was thought to be of real importance, it has been retained. That was section 22, when sequestration is awarded, because so many things hinge on that. There is no doubt at all that there is a real variety of opinion on what it means in that section, and therefore it was thought that to try and resolve that in the bill was essentially interfering with ongoing processes. My own preference is to have a single expression for this sort of immediate but not that immediate situation. Other people will have other ideas.
Thank you. Could I just put on the record at this stage, clearly the committee will have to discuss it. I think our brief discussions have left me with the impression that forthwith is not a word that we have any problems with at all. It may not be the language of the pub or the coffee shop, but it's plainly understood, I think, by people who have to think about these things. And it's no doubt an issue to which we'll return. I'm wondering then if we could move on, if we can. Forgive me. Right, in which case, I think I shall do it first with respect.
Absolutely. I really just want to pick on some of the words that you've used, Mr. Clark. You pointed out that where it's been retained, that is because there is very variation of opinion as to what it means in the context you've retained it. But your earlier remarks made the more general point. But in relation to interpreting the definition that the dictionary provides for forthwith, that no two people agree what it is. Now, in that you've made that as a general remark, not restricting it to the one place you've retained it, is there not therefore created the risk that by replacing it in other places where you contend there is perhaps less debate, there is a danger that at the cost of at the benefit of achieving internal consistency in the consolidated bill that we have before us, we create potential inconsistency with the preceding legislation, which is precisely what in a consolidation we're seeking to avoid doing. So therefore, if the word forthwith previously existed in what is now being consolidated, but you in your drafting are replacing it with without delay, is there not a very real danger that we end up with a consolidation which some may argue with legal force is inconsistent with the underlying legislation being consolidated?
I think you make a good point. My initial concern was that just the word forthwith wasn't acceptable any longer in modern English. If the committee are happy with the word forthwith, that it is, and those giving evidence are also content and have a desire to retain the word forthwith, then I would have no great unhappiness about putting it back in. I mean, it really was very much a feeling that it just wasn't a modern word.
Can I put on the record, it remains part of my vocabulary, but that merely proves that I am a child of Edwardian parents, perhaps, nothing in connection with the modern world, but there we are.
Yes. John.
Reflects the age profile of this committee with due deference to the younger members. But I too am content with forthwith for in as much as it allows an almost deliberate ambivalence, a flexibility of interpretation, which it's a mistake often made to think that the generations that went before were stupid, and because no longer, as the convener has said, the language of the pub, it loses its meaning. But I think there is an elegance in forthwith, which allows a suitable interpretation to the circumstances wherein it's required to be used.
I would certainly concede that it does allow for a certain ambiguity. I mean, the two meanings are obviously distinct, mm-hmm. And have been followed by different lawyers on different occasions. I certainly wouldn't seek to defend changing the word. I must say, I thought there'd be far more protest if I'd retained it. But
well, I think Stuart Stevenson makes the point, if you forgive me butting in on you, but I mean that we may, by so doing, inadvertently change the meaning of it. And that would not be what we should be seeking to achieve in this consolidation.
Yes, I mean, there is a clash here between consolidation should be sort of modernising language and bringing it forward. And as you say, a word where there's a genuine ambiguity of what it means probably ought to be retained in a consolidation. I mean, I'm happy to concede the point if, from my own personal point of view, but depending on what decisions might be made subsequently as to whether it should be amended or not. But from my own personal point of view, I'd be happy to go back to using forthwith. I mean, I've explained why I tried to replace it in the first instance and why I thought it ought to be retained in section 22.
Mm-hmm. Thanks so much.
I'm grateful. I think forthwith we can go on to John Mason, who will be discussing another term, which I think is to fall asleep.
Well, you've asked the question in a sense. Yes, I mean, there's been other words. We looked at plain language, and in section 27.12, it says, where sequestration has been awarded, the process of sequestration is not to fall asleep. Now, I'm familiar with the term fall asleep, but it does strike me as a little bit odd appearing in the, as a layperson, appearing in the legislation like this, and I just wonder if you think it could be improved upon and clarified.
I'm certainly not sure it could be improved upon. The question is whether it should be there at all. Is it spent? Are we justified in just cutting it out altogether? And we were not at all confident about that. I mean, does it mean anything? Is it given any meaning? In consolidating, I mean, it's in the 1985 Act. It's been there for a very long time. Nobody has thought of repealing it.
I wasn't suggesting that the concept be repealed, but more just could it be worded in a clearer, more kind of, I feel, consistent way with the rest of the legislation. Just kind of jumps out as a phrase, almost a colloquial phrase, but with, I think it means something to some legal people. I'm not sure it means something to all legal people.
Yeah. I think Mr. Fisher is very keen to share with us his knowledge of the term falling asleep and the practice of falling asleep, so that should be allowed an opportunity.
Keen, but yeah, but we did consider this quite carefully, as I think Gregor has alluded to. I mean, yeah, section 2712 has been retained, and I appreciate the committee's questions. Really, is there a way to make it clearer? But because it refers to this outdated and archaic procedural artifact in the courts, whereby cases fell asleep unless and then had to be reawakened by a procedural step, it's difficult to really improve on that without, you know, without creating doubt that you're setting up some new or referring to some new kind of procedure, and that's why we've ended up with simply retaining the current provision. I think the committee's heard that, you know, some evidence about this, and obviously the procedure is falling asleep as a concept in the courts has vanished in, you know, in the sheriff court, you know, in respect of ordinary causes is long gone, and in that sense we did consider whether it could simply, the provision could simply be removed altogether because it no longer has any currency, but because bankruptcy cases aren't ordinary cases in the courts, we felt that it would be wrong in a consolidation to unpick the decision that was taken in 1985 to retain the provision, to put beyond doubt any risk that there might be some kind of, if the provision in the 1985 Act, which says cases don't fall asleep, is the one which says that as a matter of procedure, these cases don't fall asleep, then it would be wrong in a consolidation to remove that, and that's why we've left it in, and that's why we've left it in the form that it's in. And I entirely appreciate it. It looks unusual, but that's. Why we got where we are.
I mean, I take your point that in a consolidation we wouldn't be wanting to change the law. I suppose my main point would be, do you really feel there's not a clearer way of putting this?
But I certainly can't think of a clearer way to put it, because it refers to this archaic court procedure, which doesn't really have any. You know, to explain it in procedural terms would seem to just potentially run the risk of confusing the readers of the legislation further. So okay. Happy to consider suggestions. But
Okay, fair enough. Thank you.
Sorry, could I just explore that? I just want to make sure that I have got my mind around this properly. Are you effectively saying, Mr. Fisher, that whilst this is a process which would never be used, if it were under any circumstances ever to be relevant, then falling asleep is the term which would be used in the archaic process, and therefore it needs to be referred to like that precisely because that is what it would be called were it ever to be used.
Exactly. Yeah.
Right, thank you. I think that's helpful. Thank you very much indeed. Right, I think even more detail from Mr. Stevenson.
Thank you very much, Convener. I want to address, I think, the bulk of my remarks probably to Mr. Clark as the drafter. And start by focusing on the use of abbreviations. Throughout this committee, thus far, we've managed to avoid telling anyone who's watching what ICAS means. We all know that it's the Institute of Chartered Accountants of Scotland, or is it the Institution of Chartered Accountants of Scotland? Well, there we are, you see, immediately, small doubt. So perhaps, as a matter of general principle, we should spell out abbreviations in respect of designations rather than using them. And I just wondered what consideration the drafter, Mr. Clark, had given to the striking the balance between keeping matters concise and making matters clear and unambiguous.
Yes. There are certain terms like AIB, which are used throughout the whole bill, which I think nobody objects to being used, and that's a abbreviated form. because the references occur so frequently that though the bill will be half as big again, I think, if you filled them out in full. This is a device to give certainty in situations where there might be uncertainty. But more than anything else, it's a device which has been found useful in dealing with the whole question of gender-neutral drafting. If you're not able to use he, she, his, her, him, then it's really quite difficult at times, without a great deal of prolixity, establishing, setting out a provision. So many provisions are so straightforward in the 1985 Act, and I've noticed in evidence to the committee people have saying we should go back to the wording of the 1985 Act. Well, fine, except that I can't. I have to avoid the use of he, she. The other thing is, of course, if you can avoid it by simply repeating the word, of course, but that leads to quite mind-numbing dullness at times if a word's repeated too often. If I could refer you to section 46.4 of the bill, if that was rewritten, it would read, where the creditor neither resides nor has a place of business in the UK, the trustee must, if the trustee knows where the creditor does reside or have a place of business and if no notification has been given to the creditor under section 44.3, write to the creditor, informing the creditor that the creditor may submit a claim under this section and may allow the creditor to submit an informal claim in writing. And then it goes on, the creditor commits an offence unless the creditor shows that the creditor neither knew nor had reason to believe that the statement of claim and so on was false. You get into situations like that. Of course, in other situations, if you simply repeat the noun, you actually create an uncertainty. Section 10.5, for example, translating that, where after a debtor application is made before the sequestration is awarded, a creditor concurs in the application, withdraws or dies, any other creditor may, if the conditions mentioned in subsection 6 are met, notify AIB that the other creditor now concurs in the application. What does the other creditor mean? We've repeated other creditor there, but is he referring to his other creditor? So you get into some really quite horrible situations just by repeating nouns. I noticed that there have been certain confusions here. The suggestion is made that these terms are introduced for the purpose of the bill as a whole, whereas in fact they are introduced for the purpose of the particular section you're in, just as you might say call him Bill or call her Agnes and then refer you these sort of names. They are just labels. The drafting, however, is less than ideal here because there are at least two sections where I haven't made that point clearly enough. In section 10, for example, I haven't pointed out that OC is other creditor is simply for the purpose of that section. And if that were to be retained, then the section as a whole would have to be adjusted. And there are other sections where it is less than clear. In sections 69 to 73, for example, there could be some rationalisation to make things more clear. Having said that, I think the device has been used rather too frequently in the bill. I would be content to see it disappear, for example, in 14.7, section 63, in section 113. I certainly wouldn't be offended by losing it in section 63. I don't think there would be... in section 69 to 73...
But I think in that situation, putting precise labels, 69 to 73, there's a whole lot of parties involved. There's a trustee, the new trustee, the trustee's representatives, AIB, commissioners, debtors. The label actually adds to the clarity of the provision. So I'd be very reluctant to lose it there, although it could be done without the same ugliness of constant repetition. So I think I feel that this is a device that has to be defended. I mean, the drafter does need different ways of tackling problems. I would concede I've probably overused it in the bill and that it could be adjusted. But for the most part, I think the cases in which I have used it are correct, and the other problems of construction and so on arise if you remove the possibility of using it.
That's something we will watch with interest, how you deal with that as the bill progresses. My constituents have a similar thing in the Doric, where the Aberdeenshire farmers look at a pair of shoes and say it's fit, fit, fits, fit, fit. And I leave that one for you. Nick?
Forgive me from over here. not I have to say the Doric. But simply, I am looking at Section 70, as Mr. Clark has, I think, suggested I might. And I must confess, the thing that was worrying me was that by the time I've got to 74A, and I find at the end of that phrase T, which makes perfectly good sense, if you know to go back, I think, to the right place, which is 70 sub 1, where the first line tells you that T is defined there. Now, the difficulty that I would suggest to you is that by the time you've got down to 4 and you're just pulling that out of the statute, you don't know where T is defined. And
I encourage
you to think about how we might handle that.
I agree entirely with what you say. That it had, on rereading it, occurred to me that it's the same point, and I think it could be much better done than it actually is done.
Thank you. I think that makes the point. We're in your hands. I will never claim to be a draftsman or anything. Stuart,
just a few other matters of how the bill's constructed. The first of which is that other advantages or disadvantages in reordering the bill so that certain aspects are drawn together. For example, the part dealing a moratorium on diligence or the definition of apparent insolvency. Would it be better if they appeared at the beginning? In other words, the sequencing was better. Or is that such a major task that it would be beyond contemplation at this stage?
It would certainly involve a lot of work, particularly in reconstructing the tables. Mm. But you're never going to please everyone with the order you pick. I mean, my choice of order has been subject to the comments of others while I was doing it. I really do think that everybody will have their own ideas of how to construct it, and while some of them are no doubt excellent, other people who have so far been content with the bill are on that very ground going to start protesting and saying, why not listen to me then? It's one of these situations. I don't think I've done any damage at all to meaning in the arrangements that I've followed. I've come pretty close to following the existing pattern of the 1985 Act. I've gone into the whole process much more urgently than by introducing the cast first and so on. But my basic feeling is that you're never going to please everyone, and you could play around a lot with these provisions and moving them about and so on, but you wouldn't necessarily end up with a better bill.
Well, maybe just a couple of other things that have been suggested is a merit in having a new part to cover debtor's duty to cooperate with the trustee and other responsibilities of the debtor in the bankruptcy process. It's distributed around a bit at the moment.
I'm not absolutely sure just exactly what that would involve. What the actual proposal is. I mean, I take the sort of general theme of what you're saying. Yes. I mean, it'd be one thing if an existing park could be split in two and given new headings and so on. But again, we're into the business of moving things in a way just for the sake of moving them. I mean, it's... there is nothing that springs out at me as being an obvious advantage in proceeding as you're suggesting.
One of the things that you previously suggested was moving the definition of debt advice and information package to interpretation. Wondered if there were other definitions you were...
debt advice and information package. I think the suggestion there was it be plucked out of the interpretation section and put in as a second subsection into section 3. And I'm absolutely happy with that. I mean, that makes... sense. It was, I think as I've already said, it was done originally because Section 3 was part of a very large Section 5 of the 1985 Act. So I was so intent on whittling down Section 5 that I perhaps went too far. And I think Section 3 probably would read better if the definition was taken from the interpretation section and put into that particular section, and then there was simply a cross-reference to that in the interpretation section itself.
Finally, one thing that's been put to the committee is that the trustees' powers to challenge extortionate credit entered by the bankrupt debtor is currently in section 209. It's been suggested they should be better placed in part 7, which is with powers to safeguard the interests of creditors. Do you have a view on that?
I think I would need time to consider that, and... I'm not really prepared, as it were. I mean, in the sense that I'm not personally prepared at this moment to respond to that point.
Well, if that's thought to be something that you would address and perhaps hear from you later.
Super, thank you very much. I'm wondering whether John Scott then would then like to take us on to the implementation of what's before us, please.
Yes, thank you, Irina. Back probably to the Minister now, but just what future plans are in place to communicate with stakeholders on the consolidation exercise?
My understanding is that the Counsel of Bankruptcy, who's here with us today, is together with Mr. Reid and the Scottish Government and others, have been in lengthy and detailed discussion with the stakeholders to get to this point, and that therefore there has been widespread agreement secured as to the need for this bill, the desirability for this bill, and indeed as to, broadly speaking, the content, the sequencing, and the other important issues that Mr. Clark has just explained to us. So I think we are in a fairly good place. The stakeholders are happy, they're content, they're agreed, they want to go ahead. We've looked at some of the details, the fine-tuning. But plainly, we want to do two things: to continue that engagement so that if they have any further comments to offer, perhaps especially after this session today, convener, in the light of having the opportunity to read the official report in the next few days or the next couple of weeks, they have that opportunity to contribute to the process before it is completed. So I will ask the accountant of bankruptcy to ensure that that happens, although he will be ahead of me, I imagine, and already am planning to do that. And more important, once the bill is passed and becomes law, to ensure that there's a full communication, promulgation of its terms to all relevant parties. And in my experience, this is a procedure. The engagement between the stakeholders is well established. It encompasses a large number of matters, of which this is simply part, and is more or less a continuous process. So I think we have quite a good relationship with all the stakeholders established, and that will continue. And their view, frankly, will be mostly as soon as you can get this onto the statute book, the better.
Thank you. So we can take it that discussions have taken place with organisations about the implementation of the bill, such as the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Services, and if not, that they are in hand to take place.
There's actually a meeting with the Scottish courts about court rules imminently, actually, within the next 2 weeks, I think, is the meeting. I need to check the meeting date, but it's absolutely in the diary.
Thank you. And will the guidance be available, or what guidance will be available for stakeholders and members of the public on the bill? Will that be issued in due course?
Well, that's a good question, which Mr. Reid will answer.
Well, we use the AIB website as a conduit to publish that type of information. We've already had information about the draft bill on there and relevant links. I think I mentioned at the last session that we are now moving into a series of stakeholder events that we have held across Scotland, and we will be highlighting the progress on the bill at that stage. And clearly, as the bill progresses and hopefully becomes enforced, then we will most certainly be putting announcements out about that, along with all of the relevant publications at the time.
Presumably, there is a standard textbook on all of this, which I have to say, mercifully, I have never had to read. Is anybody working with the current author, if that's the right word, of the standard textbook to make sure it's out there?
Well, we have notes for guidance, which is guidance which accompanies the legislation, and that's available, and that will be updated because clearly the references will change. So, there'll be a lot of work going on in terms of EIB systems, making sure that everything is updated for the commencement. But most certainly, one of the aspects of that will be the notes for guidance which EIB publish for mm-hmm. practitioners, which will need to be overhauled, and that work will continue in time for the commencement of the bill.
Yeah, thank you.
Discussions have taken place with stakeholders in the public, private and voluntary sectors to understand the financial impact of the consolidation exercise on their operations.
Well, I believe that the AIB has made significant effort to make all stakeholders aware of the consolidation of the bankruptcy legislation, including those ones to which Mr. Scott alludes, who are perhaps not so directly affected as the bodies representing insolvency petitioners, who are, of course, intimately concerned with the minutiae and the detail of this in every respect. But I'm assured that the AIB reaches out to wider stakeholders, and the impending consolidation of the bill has been highlighted through a news release, for example, on the AIB website in various stakeholder meetings that the AIB is involved with. But I want to stress that these are all very important matters, and it's absolutely right and helpful that they've been raised by a committee, because the law is just words on a page. It has to be communicated to everybody effectively, whatever law it is, and there has to be proper guidance, practical guidance. I have in previous years utilised and made use of the Accountant of Bankruptcy's notes for guidance to practitioners, insolvency practitioners, when I was in practice. They're extremely useful, and they do kind of flesh out the principles which are set out in the statute and turn them into a kind of comprehensive tool through the guidance. So I think practitioners value the guidance, and although there will need to be changes to it, much of it will be in the form of renumbering sections, renumbering references to sections, for example, related to debtors' offences, for example, or the list of assets and liabilities. The numbering of the sections will change. Therefore, the standard pro forma documents, some of which are set out in the guidance, as I recall, will all have to be changed. But these are essentially administrative or clerical matters, convener, but nonetheless very important ones. So between, if you like, the passing of the legislation and the commencement, there should be sufficient time for all of this work to be done. But I would stress that the AIB is kind of on the case more or less all the time with the stakeholders, and it's a highly important that should be the case, and I'm satisfied that it is the case.
Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you very much. I think Stuart Stevenson has one final question.
Minister, this is only the second consolidation bill the Parliament has dealt with since 1999, and I just wondered if you had any reflections on the process that would be of value to put in the record at this stage.
Well, I'm very pleased that, that we're proceeding with this piece of legislation, and I suppose I'm encumbered with experience, which always risks the possibility of me professing to more knowledge than in fact I possess, but it is certainly needed in bankruptcy. There's no doubt about that. And indeed, I very much hope that where it is required in other areas of law, that we can see more consolidation bills coming forward. The lion's share of the work has been carried out by the Law Commission and others working with them, and it's taken quite a long time to get here, but this is not something that I think we can be rushed. I think, as the discussion this morning illustrates, that there are so many matters of importance which may appear arcane or of a technical nature to the public. I don't imagine that the official report of this morning's proceedings will hit anybody's bestseller list anytime soon. But it's extremely important that the law is accessible and available to the people of Scotland. This is one of the roles that actually, I remember Donald Dewar said, should be one of the kind of workaday functions of this Parliament, and he is absolutely correct in that respect. So I think the procedure in this bill should, I hope, be a model for future bills, and I'm certainly satisfied that there should be more consideration given to what next needs to be done. And in this respect, we will continue to be substantially guided by the Scottish Law Commission.
Thank you. I think that draws us to a conclusion. And can I thank the Minister and his advisers? And just briefly, suspend this meeting to allow them to leave us. Minister, I may be able to take that back.
No, I'm very happy. Thank you very much to all members. And I just say I have other ministerial duties to which I must attend forthwith.
Indeed. So I'll briefly suspend this meeting. Thank you.
Resuming. Agenda item 4, instruments subject to affirmative procedure. No points have been raised by our legal advisers on the dogfouling fixed penalty Scotland order 2016 draft. Is the committee content with that instrument, please? Yes. Thank you. Agenda item 5, instruments subject to negative procedure. And again, no points have been raised by our legal advisers on the Food Information Miscellaneous Amendment Scotland Regulations 2015, SSI 2015-410, nor on the Public Service Vehicles Registration of Local Services Scotland Amendment Regulations 2015, SSI 2015-420. Is the committee content with these instruments, please?
Yes.
Okay. Agenda item 6, instruments not subject to any parliamentary procedure and no points have been raised by our legal advisers on the Tribunal Scotland Act 2014 Commencement Number 3 Order 2015 SSI 2015-422, nor the Act of Sederant Sheriff Court Rules Amendment Miscellaneous 2015 SSI 2015-424, nor the Welfare Fund Scotland Act 2015 Commencement Order 2015 SSI 2015-428. Is the committee content with these, please?
Yes.
Okay. Agenda item 7 is the Enterprise Bill. And under this item, the committee is invited to consider the powers to make subordinate legislation conferred on Scottish ministers in this UK parliamentary bill. A briefing paper has been provided and sets out the relevant aspects of the bill and comments on their effect. Does the committee agree to report to the lead committee that it is content with the delegated powers conferred on Scottish ministers in the bill and with the procedure to which they are subject?
Yes.
Does the committee also agree to draw to the attention of the Economy, Energy and Tourism Committee that the legislative consent memorandum does not explain why the regulations that may be made by the Scottish ministers under the proposed new section 153A of the Small Business Enterprise and Employment Act 2015 could extend to the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body as a relevant Scottish authority for the purposes of these regulations? This is by virtue of the provision in the new section 153B sub 5.
Yes.
Thank you very much indeed. That completes that item, and I can move this committee into private. Thank you.